So today I want to tell you about how economists approach causal questions nowadays. And let me start by noting that this approach is really traditional in many ways, but it's actually quite different than what economists used to do like 30 years ago. It's widely seen to be an important change within economics. Actually, some people call it the credibility revolution in economics. And, you know, even if you don't like such bombastic expressions, it is certainly true that if you pick up an economics journal today and read an empirical paper, it looks quite different than it would have looked like 30 years ago. And actually, it looks much simpler. It's much easier to understand. It's much more transparent. And that I think, is good news for economics. It's good news for when you try to influence, say, policy or help policymakers to make better decisions. So it's something really exciting that I want to share with you. And the easiest way to do that is through a few examples. And, you know, it's my installation talk, so I thought it's appropriate to use my own work to as examples. So let me say a few words about how I see my research agenda. I've studied kind of too many things, but I think I can argue that a lot of them are about thinking how to unleash human potential. So by human potential, I mean the kind of the best version of ourselves, kind of what each one of us could accomplish if we had a chance to develop our skills under the best possible circumstances and to put those skills to work. And, you know, sadly, this potential often gets wasted. Many people grow up without access to good education or even to sufficient nutrition. And hence, this potential doesn't turn to actual skills. And even the skills that people do acquire, they often don't get to use them because they say they can live in places with few job opportunities, they can be discriminated against in the labor market, or for a number of other reasons. And that's kind of depressing, right? But the good news is that things have gotten and can get even further better than what they have been. And this is partly because better policy. And I will try to argue that researchers can have an important role in making that policy even better than what it is today. So with that, let me move to my first example. So this starts with the spatial misallocation hypothesis. And that's a hypothesis based on the simple but important observation that if you think about what's the best predictor of somebody's income, by far, the answer is where that person lives. Observationally identical people living in different places have vastly different incomes and productivities. This is true between rich countries and poor countries, but also within countries between regions, in particular in developing countries between rural and urban areas. And that kind of suggests that many people are living in wrong places in the sense that if we would help them to move, or at least allow them to move to more productive places, it would make a big difference. But before we jump into that conclusion, we do have to stop and wonder whether that observation, these differences that we observe between, say, people living in rural and urban areas, do they really capture the effect of migration? Because people choose to migrate. It's not, you know, people who take the risk of moving to a city are different than those who stay behind in many ways. And hence, comparing them can be this apples and oranges comparison. So what we really want to do here is to answer a causal question. How would income change if we change some X, say, whether the person lives in rural or urban area? So let's think about somebody who has migrated to the city. How can we tell whether this move increased her income? Well, we can go to the city, we can find her, and we can measure her income. But that alone doesn't tell us really much about the effect. What we really want to do is to compare what she actually earns in the city to what she, the same person, would have earned had she not moved to the city. And that's the tricky thing to do, because it's counterfactual. What would have happened? Well, we can't measure it because, you know, it didn't happen. So that's really what all impact evaluation is about. How do we construct an approximation of that counterfactual? What would have happened? And there's basically two ways to do this. The kind of the traditional way in economics is to build a model, use that model to simulate different states of the world, and then you learn how those states of the world differ from each other. And that's really powerful, really wonderful thing to do. But it does come with this important limitation that every model has a bunch of many, many, many assumptions. And those assumptions are going to be wrong in some sense, always. And the question is, are they so wrong that we end up drawing wrong conclusions? And that's a really hard thing to assess. So during the past 3 decades, economists have also complemented this approach with an alternative approach of basically trying to find control groups. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. How do we find good research designs where we can make apples-to-apples comparisons? And those control groups can then capture all the complexities in the world that affect people. So the classic research design is a randomized experiment. And the power of that is that we know that the treatment group and the control group are going to be similar in every other aspect except that treatment group gets some treatment and the control group does not. So let's think about this question of returns to migration. What would be the kind of ideal experiment that would allow us to answer that question? Well, we can think about taking, say, 100,000 individuals, flipping a coin with each one of them. You get heads, you go to city, you get tails, you stay in the countryside. Then we measure their income, you know, over, say, next 20 years and see what happens. Okay, to be clear, I don't advocate running that experiment. It would be a horrible thing to do. It should not be done. So why am I talking about it? Well, thinking about these hypothetical experiments helps you understand that sometimes something resembling them takes place. These quasi-experiments or natural experiments, unintended experiments, they can provide really powerful lessons. So one example that I have used in my own work started in 1939, when the Soviet Union attacked Finland and took over the eastern parts of the country. 1/10 of the population had to be evacuated, and each person was moved to an evacuation area where the local families would host them for over the winter. And then in the spring and summer, Finland implemented this remarkable resettlement policy, where displaced people would be compensated for their lost property. And the most important form of property at the time was agricultural land. Half of the population worked in agriculture, and that's what was then given to farmers. If you were a farmer, you would get land and assistance to start a new farm. And it really was a remarkable policy. It aimed to reconstruct the pre-war situation as closely as possible. So the location you would get land from would be determined from where you came from, to match the soil quality, to match the average temperatures there. You would get your old neighbors with you in order to preserve social connections. And then you would have your farm, and you would be free to do whatever you wanted. You could sell it, you could stay. That was your choice. So in work together with Roope Uusitalo and Markus Jäntti, we've been trying to understand what was the effect of being forced to migrate. And the main result is here. So this is put together using data that follows people over several censuses and links them their tax records to this data. So it's data where we know where these people used to live before the war. And that's the horizontal axis here. For each person we ask, how far away was the home municipality before the war from the municipality from the post-war border? And there's the 0 point here, that's the new border, our current border. Everybody to the right of that had to move. On the vertical axis, we have income in 1971. And what we see in this graph is that there's this gradient. We move from west to east in Finland, the incomes tend to go down, but then there's this big discontinuity at the new border. People, farmers, who were forced to migrate, ended up earning substantially more later on. So how come? Well, we think the answer is in this graph. This is exactly the same as the one before, but now the vertical axis tells us the share of people who have moved from agriculture to urban areas to work mostly in manufacturing. And this is what we see. The people who were forced to migrate were much more likely to leave agriculture and move to the cities where the wages were much higher. Putting these two graphs together implies that leaving agriculture increased income substantially, almost roughly like 70% in the mid-20th century Finland. So then the question actually is, if it's so lucrative to move, why don't people move? I mean, 70% increase in your income, that sounds like a wonderful thing. The way we interpret this is that there must be a big cause. It's not that people, everybody are making the mistake, but this caused it to migrate. And it became less costly to migrate for the forced migrants, basically because they couldn't stay at home anymore. This is like an obvious point for, if you're not an economist, that people really value staying at home. And that's something we need to take into account when we think about, say, how do we think about regional policies today. Okay, so that's a kind of a tough example, and so let me talk about something that's much more fun. So now we get colors. Let's talk about children, you know, preschool, fun. And this goes back to where I started about how human potential gets turned into actual skills. And an important part of that process takes place in school. And an important part of the education policy is to decide, you know, for example, when school starts. And as you know, in Finland today, school kind of starts with the preschool at the year when the child turns 6 years old, and then you go to kind of real school a year after that. And what we observe is that children start that real school with quite different initial skills. And that can be a worry. It is a worry that some kids don't have enough initial skills to really benefit from school. And this is a worry that our outgoing government also shared. So when they were forming the current government or the previous government, one of the things they wrote into their agenda is that there needs to be a pilot for two-year preschool. What would happen? Would it be better if kids would start school at age five, or preschool at age five, stay there for 2 years, and have kind of a more structured, still a lot of playing, but still somewhat more structured education before they start school. So is this a good idea? Well, that's what you need a pilot for, right, to think about, is it a good idea? But how would you actually do it? So again, we can think of an experiment that would settle the matter. So let's take 30,000 children, randomize them into treatment and control. The treatment starts preschool at age five, the control at age six. And let's see what happens. Now, you know, it sounds a bit fanciful to do something like this, but we got to ask what should we do, and this is what we told. And to my great surprise, that's what the government did. So 15,000 families have gotten a letter like this during the past 2 years, telling them that congratulations, your child starts preschool at age five, so we expect you to show up here next fall. 20,000 families have gotten, you know, a less colorful letter saying that your child is part of a control group and nothing really changes. That's a big thing. You know, we are really kind of altering the way these children's lives. We need to do that responsibly. And you know, the way it was implemented was that the government or the parliament set a special law just for this experiment. That law that was a normal process of making sure that law is kind of okay. It also came with 30 million euro budget and ability to use data in ways that wouldn't be possible without the law. And now in 2025, we will actually know, is it a good idea, or what's the kind of cost benefits of extending preschool by 1 year? So I hope these two examples give you some sense of how exciting it is to be an empirical economist today. You know, there's these new approaches, new data sources, new collaboration, and this opportunity to do great science, which also directly speaks to policy. So if you want to hear more, you know, you can find me and my colleagues from the third floor of the business school. Thank you.